Hi everybody, can you see what I'm doing today? I'm sneaking around the garden. Sneak. If you sneak, it means you creep around silently. You are trying to avoid being seen or heard. You are sneaking. The word sneak can be used as a noun and a verb. You sneak around. A person who is always nosy and inquisitive can be described as a sneak. Welcome to another Sunday. Yes, it is a very chilly day. It feels as if spring is in the air, even though it's quite cold. In fact, in the distance, there is snow on the hills. Coming up today, we have lots of things, including signs that you are getting older. Also, Mr. Steve will be here as well. We will be taking a look at some lovely springtime video clips as well. And of course, you are more than welcome to join in on the live chat. After all, it's a Sunday afternoon. It's just after 2 o'clock here in the UK. And this is English in Your Ear Live.
Ear, Mr. Duncan, where are you? We're waiting for you. We are waiting for you to arrive. Where are you? Come on, Mr. Duncan, press your buttons. Oh, here we go. Oh my goodness. Are we really on? Are we live? Has another week already passed by? I can't believe it. Hi everybody, this is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I really, really hope so. Are you happy? Well, are you happy? I hope so. Here we go. Once again, we are live together, the whole world reunited in peace and tranquility as we begin another live stream for a Sunday afternoon. Here we are already halfway through March. Can you believe it? Beware the Ides of March, as they say. So it's myself, Mr. Duncan. I am a teacher. I teach English on YouTube, and I have been doing so for many, many years. In fact, I think it's too many years. I think I've been doing this for too long. Is it possible to be on YouTube for too long? I wonder. So thanks for joining me today. I am live from my little studio in England, for those who aren't sure what this is all about. So English is the name of the game, and I will be with you for the next hour and 53 minutes of live English. Thanks for joining me today. First of all, let's have a look outside, shall we? Because it's a rather unsettled day here in the UK. Look outside. That is actually a live view out of my studio window. Now, I always like to play a little game when I look out of my window. I always like to see if I can spot any cars on the road in the distance. So for the next few seconds, oh, there's one now. Just as I mentioned it, there was a car. Oh, there's another one. Now that looks like a van. Can you see the van going by in the distance? So sometimes during the day when I'm feeling a little bit bored and I have nothing to do, I like to stare out the window and I like to spot the cars, especially white vans. I get very excited whenever I see a white van, because I always think that there is a delivery on the way to my house. So I always get very excited during those moments of time when I see a white van, because when I see a white van, it means that there might be a delivery coming my way. I don't know what it is about deliveries. I love getting deliveries, especially when it's something nice that I've ordered from the internet. So yeah, that's the view outside. Did you see the cars? So if you have a moment of time, a moment when you have nothing to do, maybe you can look out the window and see what you can see out of the window. Maybe you can spot some birds. Maybe you can see some unusual vehicles going by. Or perhaps you can be a little nosy and look at what your neighbour is getting up to. So here we go. And of course, the live chat is also up and running. Let's have a look at the live chat. A lot of people like to see the live chat. So let's put it on the screen right now. Oh, yes, we have a lot of people already on the live chat. So let's go back to the beginning. I want to see who was first on the live chat today. I don't know who was first because I was busy setting up the equipment. So let's have a look. Let's see who was first. Oh, I see. It looks as if we have Julia on the live chat. You are first today, so I think that deserves a round of applause. Congratulations to you, well done. And you will notice on my other camera, if we have a look, you will see that later on we have Mr. Steve, who will be sitting over there. So later on, we do have Mr. Steve coming, for those who are big fans of the multi-award-winning Mr. Steve. I'm not joking. He is now officially a multi-award winner. That's all I can say, because most of it is very top secret, you see. So the live chat is busy, and we have Julia, We also have Matrix. Hello, Matrix. Also, we have Emma, Bella, Chris, TS. Hello to Martha. Hello, Martha. I haven't seen you for a long time, Martha.
Here, Martha. What have you been getting up to?
Scotty. Or is it Sotty? Oh, sorry. It's Sotty or Soty. Hello to you as well. Gosia is here. Pedro, one of our moderators, he is here and very eager. Also, we have Lilia and also Matarin Blue Thunder. Hello, Blue Thunder. Nice to see you here as well. Emma, also Kira, Eric, and also Jeff. Hello to Jeff, watching in the United States of America, in Florida, if I'm not mistaken. Hope we are learning something new today, says Chris. Well, I always try to bring something new. I always like to bring something different to the party. That's a great expression. That means if you bring something to the party, it means you bring something with you that might be useful or something that will help you to learn new things. Also, we have Anna. Louis is here as well. And Bella. Alberto. Hello, everyone. Unfortunately, I cannot watch today's live program. I have a family lunch. So can I send huge hugs and awesome? Oh, it looks as if Alberto likes the new look. Do you like the new look? Lots of things have changed. We changed everything last week, in fact. What is the weather like today? Yes, it's pretty awful outside. It's freezing cold. In the distance, we've had a lot of snow. Not around here, but very high up on the mountains in the distance. David Enrico says, this is the first time that I've joined Mr. Duncan live. I'm very excited to be here. Now I live in London, but I am having many problems with my English. Please help me, Mr. Duncan. Well, David, first of all, congratulations for being first today. It is your first time on the live chat. So can I first of all say congratulations for being here for the first time, and I think we'll have some fireworks to welcome David Enrico to the live stream. So I hope you enjoyed that, and I hope you will become a regular viewer. Emma says, I love sneaking. If you sneak around, it means you move around quietly because you don't want to be noticed. You are trying to do something very discreetly, hidden from view. Welcome back, Mr. Duncan. Thank you, Farah. That's very kind of you. Mr. Duncan, thanks for everything and welcome back. Ezra, thank you for thanking me. And also thank you for saying hello. Alexandra is here. Also, we have Emma. Hello, Emma. And Sue Cat. Hi, Sue Cat. I haven't seen you for a while. Thank you very much. And it's nice to see you back. Mega B says, it is my first time here and also my first step towards fluency. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mega. And I suppose we should have some fireworks for you as well. Well done. Welcome. Welcome to the live stream. And I hope you will join me every week. Very nice. We also have Dwi Njuk here, who is watching in Vietnam. And yes, a very common question. Many people ask this. They ask, Mr. Duncan, how do I improve my English? Well, there are many ways to do that. There are many ways to improve your English. Practice English every day. That is always a good tip. Also, try to learn some new words every day. So maybe 4 or 5 new words every day. Try to memorize them
And never be afraid to repeat yourself. Never be afraid to say things over and over again, because one of the best ways to learn anything is through repetition. Trust me. Also, we have Jordao. Hello, Jordao. Here I am again. My 7-year-old daughter, Anna, is by my side doing her maths homework. Please say a big hello to her. So a big hello to Anna Cecilia. And I hope you are doing well with your maths. As I mentioned last week, I am not very good at mathematics. I am absolutely dreadful at maths. Not very good at all. So I hope you are doing better than I did when I was at school. I wasn't very good at maths, to be honest. It's a special day today because it's St. Patrick's Day. Thank you very much to all of those who have already said Happy St. Patrick's Day, Mr. Duncan. Now, I'm not Irish, but it is an Irish celebration, so St. Patrick's Day. So a big hello to all those who are celebrating St. Patrick's Day today. And we will be talking all about that a little bit later on with Mr. Steve, because, yes, he is here today. Mr. Steve will be here in around about 10 minutes' time. It's a Sunday. It's a fun day. It's time to improve your English listening. And here we are again. I hope you are feeling well. Spring is in the air. Would you like to see some lovely spring sights? Oh, I can't resist this. I can't resist showing this to you. So let's enjoy what I would describe as a very typical springtime sight here in the UK. Thank you. so lovely. Did you see the little lambs there? And yes, there are lambs running around all over the place, very close to where I live. It's a Sunday, it's a fun day. Yes, we are learning English, we are improving our English. In fact, there are many things that we'll be doing today. We'll be talking about a lot of things. It's St. Patrick's Day, as I mentioned earlier. Also this week, there was a very special birthday celebrated all around the world. Do you know what it was? A big birthday, a big celebration. It was 30 years ago this week that something happened. Do you know what it was? Something very, very special. And no, it wasn't Mr. Steve and myself meeting up for the first time. It wasn't that, even though that was 30 years ago. It was something else, something very special. Also later on, we're talking about the weather, because the weather is pretty awful today. It's cold, it's windy, we had lots of rain. And I thought today we would have a look at some words, idioms and phrases to do with the weather. Now, I know we've done this before, but these will be some new ones. So some new idioms, some new expressions to do with the weather. And of course, if there is one thing that British people enjoy doing, it is talking about the weather. We are obsessed with the weather. We love talking about it all the time. Let's have another look at the live chat, and then Mr. Steve will be here very soon. So let's have a little look at the live chat. Do, 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 do. Oh, it's very busy on the live chat. I've already noticed that a lot of people are here. Thank you very much for joining me today. Some very interesting questions as well. Now, let's go back slightly and see. Jesus Vega asks, I hope you don't mind me asking, but could you tell me the difference between England and the UK? Well, first of all, England is one country. The UK is many different countries collected together in a group known as the United Kingdom. So the United Kingdom consists of England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. So that is the United Kingdom. When we talk about England, we are just talking about the one place, England, the country. And that is, of course, also where the seat of government sits as well, in London. So England is the country. The United Kingdom is the collective term for England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland as well. So I hope that clears that question up. I had a message from Sudan. Oh, hello. Hello, Davel Bait or Beat. I hope I pronounce your name right. I am Adam from Sudan. Please, if you don't mind, I would like to ask you a question. Have you ever been to Sudan? I have never been to Sudan ever. So I can safely say that I've never been there. I definitely haven't been there, but I might have been there in one or two of my dreams, you see. So I might have been there in my subconscious, but I've never been there in real life. Sucat says, in Argentina, there must be many Irish people because there are parties everywhere. Yes, today is St. Patrick's Day. You are right, yes. Thank you also to Chris, who says, spring is so warm and a very cool season. Quite refreshing. It's a refreshing sight to behold. Thank you very much. I'm glad you enjoyed the video that I played a few moments ago of the lambs playing in the field. And at the moment, it is lambing season here in the UK. So many lambs are now being born,
And around where I live, there are lots of farms and lots of sheep farms. So there are lots of lambs running around at the moment. So yes, it's a lovely sight. I love springtime so much. I really do. Palmyra says, the Berlin Wall's fall occurred in autumn. Yes, I believe it did. Yes, the anniversary as well was last year. There was a big anniversary. And I think there will be a big one this year as well. Mirella, hello, Mr. Duncan and everyone. Thank you very much. And a big hi to Grace. Hello, Grace Chin, watching in Malaysia. Hello to you. Malaysia is a country that I know very well because I've been there so many times. I love Malaysia very much. And it is a country that I've been to lots and lots of times in the past. So I'm glad to see you here today. By the way, can I say a big hello to all those who have made donations to help my work continue? You will see underneath, you will see that there is an address on PayPal where you can send donations if you wish to help my work continue. And I do spend a lot of time producing these live streams, and you may have noticed a new change this week on my YouTube channel. I have started putting daily lessons. So there will be new lessons on my YouTube channel from Monday to Friday. So every day of the week, there will be a new short lesson. And I hope in the future, I will be able to make a playlist. And the playlist will be called Everyday English. So that is what the playlist will be called. So last week, you may have noticed that there were some new lessons on my YouTube channel, and there will be new lessons published every day. So on Monday, a new lesson. On Tuesday, there will be a new lesson. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, a new lesson. So a new lesson coming every single day. Can you believe it? Can I believe it? I don't know, really. This week, there was a special anniversary. Yes, this week, we celebrated the birthday of the internet. Happy birthday to the internet. The internet is 30 years old this week. Can you believe it? 30 years old. So way back in 1989 was when the first ever World Wide Web address was typed into a very old-fashioned computer. And it was this week, 30 years ago, that the internet was born. Now, some people think that the internet is a bad thing. Some people think that the internet is a good thing. Some think it's both. So maybe it is a thing that can be used for both good and bad. So what do you think? Now, first of all, my opinion is in the middle. So I think that the internet is pretty good and also at times pretty bad, as we saw this week with the terrible, absolutely awful events that took place in New Zealand. But there is always a positive side and a negative side to everything that comes along. Now, that's just my opinion. So even though the internet is often maligned, it is often criticized for being a place where bad things happen, it is also a place where good things happen. And I hope that this live stream is one of the positive things that happens on the World Wide Web as we celebrate 30 years of the internet. We'll be right back. We are live. And now, for those who are wondering who the guy in the photograph is, who is the man in the photograph? Well, he is the guy who invented, he created the World Wide Web. His name is Tim Berners-Lee, and he is the guy who is responsible for the internet. He is the guy who is responsible for everything you see and hear right now. But what do you think? Do you think the internet is a good thing or a bad thing? And when you are on the internet, what do you normally look at? So when you go on the internet, when you browse the internet, what do you normally view? What do you normally watch? What do you normally look at? I know that some of you are going to say, we always like to watch your lessons, Mr. Duncan, which is very kind of you. Thank you very much for saying that. So here he comes. Yes, it is now just after 2:30 on a Sunday afternoon. And yes, it is the guy who everyone loves, the multi-award winning. I'm not joking. He is now the multi-award winning Mr. Steve.
Hello. Hello, Mr. Dan. How are you, Mr. Duncan? And how is everybody else out there in the 30-year-old World Wide Web of English?
Can you believe it?
Well, I can't. No. Well, we've known each other for 30 years, and we worked out this morning that the... When did we meet? It was in, it was on your birthday, of course, wasn't it? So a few months before, just after the internet was invented or went live.
5 months.
We met. So that and I can't believe that all those years ago, there was no internet. So I wish there still wasn't, because I don't like it.
Can you remember the days, Steve, before the internet came along? So can you actually remember the internet, or should I say the pre-internet days? What did you do? What did we all do when there was no internet?
We used to write with a pen on pieces of paper.
Writing.
That's what we used to do. We used to write things down.
You know what, Steve? I can't remember the last time I wrote anything down.
Do you know, when you try now, sometimes, occasionally, if you go to somewhere, a lecture or somewhere, or we've got a teleconference at work and I want to write things down. I used to be able to write for like an hour non-stop, particularly when I was a student. You used to have to take lots of notes. So if you're a student, I don't know whether you still do as a student. Do you take down handwritten notes when you go to a lecture? But I used to be able to write for like an hour. But now, if I write for more than about 3 minutes, my fingers ache. Of course, that could be age. But my writing is awful now. It just looks untidy.
Yeah.
Because you just don't write very much anymore.
But it is.
You just type onto a keyboard.
Yes, it's very strange, though, isn't it? When you sit down to write something, and as you just said, after a few moments, your fingers start to ache and hurt, and you think it feels so strange. Also, the other problem I have is that my handwriting is terrible. The teachers at school, when I was at school, the teachers would always criticize me. They would say, Duncan, your handwriting, it's like a spider has crawled across the page. So quite often I would be criticized. But I think nowadays, Steve, that in the classrooms, everything is very high tech. So they have their iPads, and everything is now projected onto a screen. So they don't have blackboards anymore.
Whiteboards they used to have. Do they have whiteboards now?
No, it's all computerized now. It's
giant
all
screens. Is it in the classroom? I don't know.
Well, they project everything. They have a projector which just projects everything onto a large screen in the classroom. So it's all very modern now. I think if you and I went back to school, I think we'd be quite shocked, because everything now is technologically based.
And of course, everything now you say or do is recorded forever Whereas, you know, if you were a teacher and you wrote something on a blackboard, you could rub it out. And unless someone had taken a picture of it, which they wouldn't have done because you wouldn't be taking cameras into school because there weren't iPhones and, well, cameras, phones with cameras in them. Of course, one thing which is brilliant about the web is information.
Yes.
It now means that everyone has access to virtually anything, and you can very quickly research anything. You used to have to go to a library and look at encyclopedias. I think for probably in-depth, maybe scientific work, you probably don't find all that information on the internet. I don't know, but certainly for most general knowledge, I think you can find it on the internet, and there's certainly a lot more than you would have found.
Mm.
It was always a goal, wasn't it? Something that every household wanted was a set of encyclopedias.
Yes.
And there were usually 12 sort of big, thick volumes, usually in alphabetical order, to do with everything in the world, and was contained within these 12 volumes. And everybody was proud to have a set of them in their living room, in their light, you know, on their bookcase. And if you wanted to look something up, you went there. And we had them at home. We had my grandfather's, which were like 50 or 60 years old. So they were sort of turn of the last century. So we're talking sort of 1920 they were. And I've still got those. I used to love them. They were fascinating. But of course, they're all out of date. As soon as you produce anything now, because of the pace and development of new information and new knowledge, you couldn't possibly produce a set of encyclopedias because they would be out of date as soon as they were published.
Yes, it's a bit like most things with like scientific books or reference books. But I always think that people bought these encyclopedias just to look intelligent. So they bought them and put them on their bookshelf.
Yes.
But they never looked at them. But it probably didn't. But it made them appear as if they were intelligent. But I think nowadays, I'm not sure. See, I have a kind of love-hate relationship with the internet. So I love it for certain reasons and I hate it for other reasons. But I also think that maybe the idea that the internet makes us cleverer or more knowledgeable is actually false, because we tend not to remember things anymore because we know that we can just look on the internet. We can just Google things. We can just look on the internet. So I think in many ways we might actually not be cleverer or smarter nowadays because we don't bother to keep things in our brains because we can just search on the internet for it.
So yes, maybe we're developing new skills that we didn't have before. I mean, we touched on this last week. I mean, my mother can still, and certain lots of people of her sort of generation, and probably of ours as well, we can still do mental arithmetic quite easily, adding up, taking away, dividing, working out percentages in our heads, because that's what we had to do before calculators were. Anyway, we're rambling a bit, and I haven't even looked at the live chat yet, Mr. Duncan.
Well, the live chat is very brisk. It's very brisk.
Can I have a look?
Do you like that word, brisk?
Brisk.
Something very busy, hectic.
Yes.
Very brisk.
A bit like today's show.
If you were working in a shop and you had lots of customers come through the door and you had a very busy day, you can say that the business today was very brisk.
Yes.
Oh, I like that word. So, yes, Mr. Steve wants to see the live chat. Okay, then. There it is.
Oh, well, of course, it's on this new screen. It's very small, Mr. Well, Duncan.
Just for you, Steve.
Make it bigger?
I will try. Wait there a second.
Because that's the other problem with staring at screens all the time, is that your eyesight becomes very bad.
Oh.
In fact, that is a medical condition that young people, when they're growing up from a very young age, have developed very poor short-sightedness, or I can never, well, they can't see long distances very well.
Okay, that's short-sighted.
Okay, so they can see short distances, but they can't see long distances. And that's because apparently if you spend a lot of your time when you're young looking at a screen, you're focusing on something that's very near, very close to you, and your eyeball actually changes shape because your body is adapting to the fact that it thinks you want to just look at things which are close by.
Yes.
And, you know, before we had screens and internet, we'd be outside and our eyes would be focusing on long distance objects all the time.
So it has nothing to do with teenagers looking at too much internet porn.
Well, just looking at the internet. Oh, I see what you mean. Yes,
because my family used to, my parents used to always say, especially my mum, she said, you know, if you look at those dirty magazines and dirty pictures and rude things, you'll go blind.
I'm trying to be serious, Mr. Duncan.
Oh, okay.
Apparently, yes. If you spend your young years looking at screens all the time and phones, your eyes, and you're spending more time indoors, which young people apparently are, they're not going outside playing with their friends, then your eyes become adapted to not focusing on long distance objects, sort of the horizon or lots of things in the distance, and therefore you have to have glasses, and the proportion of young people having glasses is going up apparently. Well, because of this problem, because your eyeball changes shape.
Yes, well, that's why I'm short-sighted, because my eyes are actually a little wonky. They're wonky, they're a little crooked, and also I can't see over long distances, so I can see fairly near, but I can't see things far away. But that affected me around the age of 7, and I know for a fact that it has nothing to do with the internet, because there was no internet. It was only 30 years since the internet was invented. Do you remember this sound, Steve? Listen to this sound and see if you remember it.
Oh, yes. The sound of trying to connect to the internet.
So there it is. So that's the sound.
Ooh, my ears, Mr. Duncan. That's a bit loud. We've got people watching from all over the world. It's incredible. Syria, we've got somebody from Russia, from Kaliningrad.
But
St. Patrick. Have you talked about St. Patrick?
We've mentioned it briefly. We will be talking about it because I believe you have some information. But can you remember when you used to have to connect to the internet, Steve?
Yes.
And you used to have to do it through your phone line.
And That's right.
Sometimes it would take ages to connect.
Yes, the RHS says the internet is magic. We can improve a lot with it. That is true. That is true, because you can just look up anything. Of course, you've got to be certain that the source of information is accurate.
Hmm.
There have been doubts over Wikipedia, but I think that is generally reasonably accurate. And you may have to cross-check your information with other sources just to make sure.
Well, one of the problems with Wikipedia, especially Wikipedia, is some people go on there and they like to make mischief, so they go on there and they change things because just for fun. So maybe certain things about a certain personality might be changed, and then some people mistake it for a real story or real news. So quite often people will go onto the internet to cause chaos or to create mischief.
Dial-up. Mm. Yes, that's what it was called.
Yes.
Says Lydia. And of course, Anna says, the internet is wonderful to learn languages. So without the internet, we wouldn't be doing this today.
That's true.
So we shouldn't knock it too much. We shouldn't criticize the internet too much, because we're not doing anything nasty here. We're doing hopefully positive things.
Yes. And also hopefully interesting things.
Yes, I mean, look at all the people from all the different countries watching us today. Every time I look at the screen, somebody from a different country is saying hello to us, which is lovely.
Now, I remember the first time you got a computer, Steve, in your work,
And that was around 1997 that you first got your computer for your job, because they updated everything and they gave you a laptop. And it was very, very basic back then. So in the sort of late 90s. And we didn't buy our first PC until, I think it was 2000, Steve.
I can believe that.
Yes. So we had our first personal computer in 2000.
Yeah.
And that was it. So I've been on the internet officially. I've been on the internet since 2000. So this is now my 19th year using the internet. But of course, this week it was 30 years old. So the 30th anniversary. So what's going on the live chat, Steve?
Lots of things. As I said, lots of people from different countries watching us and saying hello. Estanislao says, I became short-sighted at 40.
Oh.
So there we go. So that is an age-related sight deficiency. As you become older, it becomes difficult to look at short distances, and you have to have glasses, so for reading,
yes,
things like that. And this is something that I am beginning to suffer from, something that my family laugh at me because I'm having to hold menus at arm's length.
What I love is when, because your sister likes to make fun of you, doesn't she?
Yes. Well, she gets a little obsessed with it. Every time I see my sister, she seems to think that I need to have my eyes tested. I mean, I probably do, but I'm not going to wear glasses for reading. I'm doing everything. I'm doing exercises. I'm continually looking at things with very small writing in order, because I think that helps to keep your eyes in good shape.
Oh, I see.
And you can do exercises, and there are books on it which I've got, to try and preserve your eyesight. Because once you start wearing glasses, everybody says the same thing. Once you start wearing them for reading, you can never go back, because your eyes then become weak straightaways, because you're not using the muscles to their full strength. So I'm doing all sorts of exercises to try and make sure that my eyesight will continue for as long as possible. And I cover up one eye and I look at things and try and focus. I cover up the other one, then I do sort of these sort of, well, nobody's watching because they can't see me, but I do all these exercises, and there are books on it.
Well, we can see you.
Can you?
Yes.
Oh, I don't know what you can see at the moment.
Well, you wanted to see the live chat, so you've got it.
But people can still see me.
Yes, that's just the live chat you're looking at.
Thought I was invisible, Mr. Duncan. I didn't know people could see me.
Well, make your mind up.
Well, I can see the screen here, but I can't see me, so I don't know what's possible. What's visible?
There you go.
Oh, is that what people are seeing? Oh, I see, right. Yes, so there we go. I'll turn to the side. So this is one exercise you can do. There we go. And you've got to keep your focus as you draw your finger in, to the point it becomes out of focus. And you can do it. Yes, so that's it. So there's something. There's a piece of paper with some writing on it. And the idea is that you pull it in as far as possible. Oh, till it actually aches.
Well, what you're actually doing there is training the eyes to focus.
The muscles, yes. You're keeping the muscles strong, and you can do it with, because you see, I've identified that one of my eyes is weaker than the other.
Yes.
Yes, it's that one. So I'm trying to strengthen that one. There we go. It's just going out of focus there.
Okay.
And then hold it for a bit. It's like doing doing exercises with weights.
Yeah.
All your muscles in your eyes are being and then after you've done that, you sort of look at, you either cover your eyes up like that and relax them, and or look at something in the far distance and focus on that.
Yes, but of course, Steve, you are missing the big one. Nowadays, a lot of people have surgery on their eyes.
Oh, laser surgery. Yes,
you see, now this is something I would never have done for two reasons. First of all, I would never have it done because I don't want lasers being shone into my eyes and having my eyes cut to pieces with lasers. So that's the one thing. Also, I wouldn't be able to have it. because my eyesight is very poor. So I have terrible eyesight. I'm almost if I take my glasses off, I am completely blind. I can't see a thing.
You can't.
I can't. So my eyesight is terrible. So I would never be able to have laser surgery on my eyes because my eyesight is too bad.
Well, I know some people that have had laser surgery. I know somebody at work who's had it done, and they've now had it done twice, and must be 10 years, I think they've had it done twice, and they've been very pleased with it. But I don't know whether I would want to have that done, but have to cross that bridge when we come to it. That must be an idiom, Mr. Duncan.
A lot of
cross
people
that are, bridge when we come to it.
Yes, a lot of people are reminiscing today about the internet. So a lot of people remembering the early days of computers, and Lilia mentions floppy disks. Do you remember floppy disks?
If you're referring to those disks that were used for memory, yes. I do remember floppy disks. Yes.
There's nothing worse than
having disk-shaped and they were floppy.
There's nothing worse than having a floppy disk.
It was like a magnetic sort of. It was like sort of tape, but on a disk, wasn't it?
Tape on a disk.
Computers. It was magnetic, wasn't it?
Yes. It was it was basically a disk.
It was basically a magnetic disc that would, exactly. You can see how things are advancing all the time. I bought a new laptop recently.
Yeah.
Because my other one was probably 10 years old and wasn't working very well. And they don't come anymore with disc drives in them for reading a disc. What am I talking about? Like DVD, if you want to play a DVD in your laptop, you usually press a button, it would spring out, then you put the disc in and close it, wouldn't you?
Yes, there's no DVD player now.
DVD players don't come on laptops now. You have to, because everything is, even all the programs or the software is coming via the internet.
Yes.
Probably also saves money, but... There you go.
But we were talking about this morning. I was talking about DVDs and the fact that people don't buy movies or TV shows anymore on DVD because now you can just stream it from the internet. So there will be a time when we won't see DVDs anymore. What are you doing, Steve?
I'm trying to look at the screen. Jesus Vega says... that a lot of people, of course, are using the cloud to save their information now. So you don't need disks or even those sort of plug-in little hard, what do you call those little plug-in?
Flash drives.
You don't even really need those now because you can save everything onto the cloud. But is that secure? Who is looking at your information?
Well, the whole point of the cloud is, now I don't really use it. I don't use the cloud very much. I like to back up everything on my computer using external hard drives. People can see you, by the way, Steve.
I know. Well, I need to get a little
okay. I can make it larger, but you won't be able to see what's going out on air.
No, that's fine. I'm fine. Says my first PC was a Commodore 64. I remember that.
Oh my goodness, that's really going back in time.
And of course, I learned a bit of what was that other popular one that was out when we were growing up? We could buy computers.
Yes. Well, there was a British version. There was the Sinclair.
The Sinclair. That's right. Yes.
There was now I remember the first time I saw a computer that you could just buy from the shops. It was a Sinclair ZX81.
That's right.
Who remembers the ZX81? A terrible piece of equipment. It didn't even have a keyboard. It just had a flat piece of metal, and you had to press really hard on the piece of metal to make the keys work. And it was dreadful. It was an awful piece of equipment.
Who remembers Sinclair products? There were loads of them. He was I think he's no longer with us.
That's it.
Clive Sinclair. He was like an entrepreneur, and I was Oh, it was so exciting when I was at school.
Well, he was an inventor.
He was an inventor, yes, he was. Very clever, but unfortunately, anything he produced was always unreliable. I had a watch, a Sinclair Black Watch, it was called.
Okay.
And it was the most futuristic. It was so exciting. I was probably about 16 at the time, 15. It was the most exciting thing I'd ever seen. And you could buy all the bits, all the individual parts, and put it together and make it yourself.
So you would build your own watch?
Build your own watch. And it was... didn't have any buttons on it. It was LEDs then. It wasn't even, it was red LEDs.
Yes, but that's, but I always remember that in a James Bond film with Roger Moore, Live and Let Die. And he's in the dark and he presses his watch and then the watch lights up with these little red numbers. It was amazing.
It was so exciting. That was in the sort of mid 1970s.
Yeah.
And you could buy a watch with red LED numbers on it. I was one of the first people at school because I used to love electronics. I used to do soldering and buying all individual components. I used to love making my own sort of electronic equipment at home. And so I bought one of these black watches, as the Sinclair Black Watch. If you look it up on the internet, I'm sure you can find it. But the problem was, it was just dreadfully unreliable. It just kept going wrong. It just kept showing the wrong time. You couldn't adjust it. They were just woefully unreliable, and they kept bringing out updates, but they never did work.
So the early days of computers, we had the ZX81 in this country. I don't think you could buy it anywhere else in the world. It was only available in this country. So Sinclair was just a British company. So I don't think they exported anything overseas. But yes, the early days of computers. And the reason why we're mentioning that is because this week we celebrated the 30th anniversary of the internet. Oh, dear.
Oh, Mr. Duncan, that horrible sound, it went on for ages and then it still wouldn't work.
Yes. Well, do you remember what they used to call it? It was called 56K.
56K, was it?
That was the connection speed of the internet all those years ago. 56 kilobytes. That's all it was. Do you know what my internet connection is now, as we speak now?
Go on, tell me.
It is 72 megabytes a second.
Right. 56, yes. Somebody, David, has said 56 kbps.
Kilobytes per second.
Kilobytes per second. So now, you reckon you're on what now, Mr. Duncan?
Now it's about 72 megabytes a second.
So what's the difference between a kilobyte and a megabyte?
Well, as I understand it, 1,000 kilobytes, 1,000 kilobytes is 1 megabyte.
I think you're right.
So
it's about 1,000 times faster now, then.
Yes. So from all those years ago when we had to sit for hours and hours. And do you remember, Steve, when you had to open a photograph on your computer?
Oh, you didn't bother, did you? You'd try to open it, go and make a meal, go for a walk, and then come back, and it could have opened by the time you came back.
Yes, because what would happen is the photograph would open very slowly because the connection was slow. So you would only get half of the photograph, and sometimes you would only get maybe a quarter of the photograph, or sometimes if you were very lucky you would get to see the whole photograph. But you had to go away, as Steve just said, you would have to go away and wait for the photograph to slowly load onto the computer. Amazing. Absolutely.
Lots of people commenting about James Bond. It was very exciting, James Bond, in the 70s, because you saw all this technology, and most of which now we're all using.
Yes.
But watches, digital watches, were so exciting.
We're all driving around in our undersea cars.
Yes. And of course later, the only problem with LED, the red LED watches, is that the batteries only lasted about a month because they used a lot of power. So when they brought out LCD watches, they used power.
What does LCD mean?
Well, LED is light emitting diode.
Okay.
LCD, I'm not quite sure what that means.
It's liquid crystal.
Liquid crystal. So that uses a fraction of the power.
Yes. But of course, the problem is you can't see liquid crystal in the dark.
No, LEDs, I thought, look better. LEDs, actually, that red LED looked, and I think it still looks more futuristic.
You know, the thing is, if you're going to have technology, it has to have lights on it.
Exactly.
It does.
Computers, any film, television series where computers or robots are concerned,
yeah,
whenever you open them up, if there's a robot and a piece of its head comes away,
yeah,
there's always lots of LEDs flashing inside.
There's always... I never understood why there are flashing lights inside a robot.
No, because you can't. That's just telling you, oh, this is a robot.
Yes.
And all those programs we used to watch about the future.
About the future.
There'd always be banks of computers with LEDs flashing away, lights everywhere,
yes,
using huge amounts of power.
Don't forget. Do you remember, Steve, in the 70s and late 60s, if ever they had computers, they always had those big giant tapes, those big tape reels that were always spinning around.
That's right, they were, yes. Yes.
So that was what computers looked like in the 1960s and 70s. But of course, nowadays you can almost put it in your pocket. You can put a computer in your pocket nowadays. It's incredible.
Ute R says, I used to develop software under DOS.
Oh, wow.
Of course, it's like the equivalent of Betamax and VHS, isn't it, with video tech. I don't know whether DOS is still used. It's probably an old-fashioned form of computer programming that is no longer used, I would imagine.
Well, even the internet isn't the same internet now, so all the technology that's used back then isn't even used anymore. It's all obsolete nowadays. It's all HTML4, if I'm not mistaken, which means you can view and look at many different things on the internet. Are you okay there, Steve?
I've got a bit of a runny nose, Mr. Duncan.
That's good. That's
because I've been outside and it's very cold and windy.
Well, it is, yes. I was outside earlier, sneaking around the garden. So we're going to have a little break.
Okay.
Let's have a little break. And at 3:05, we are having a break. And then we'll be back with Mr. Steve. We have some words and expressions to do with the weather. Also, we'll be talking about St. Patrick's Day as well.
Yes.
What is St. Patrick's Day all about? We'll be talking about that and lots of other things as well. So please don't go away.
We'll be right back.
I hope you enjoyed that. Some flags of the world. It's a Sunday. It's a fun day. It's time to improve your English. I'm very aware that I have coffee breath. I had a lovely cup of coffee earlier, and all I keep smelling is my own breath. There's nothing worse. I think possibly the worst thing ever you can do is breathe your coffee breath all over someone. I don't know what Steve thinks, but it is quite bad if you have coffee breath. So I'm very sorry about that. I don't get too close to the screen because I have coffee breath.
It's foul, coffee breath.
Sorry, Steve?
Coffee breath is nasty.
Yes.
I think coffee breath smells like a bit like cigarette breath.
Yes.
It's very similar.
It is true though, isn't it, Steve? Because coffee, the smell of coffee on your breath smells just like cigarettes.
Well, I've said this before, but if you've got ground coffee, if you are quite posh, most people use instant coffee at home, but if you've got a good income, you might well have purchased for yourself a nice coffee maker that uses the ground coffee. But you can buy the ground coffee and then make your own coffee just in a flask, can't you? And you push it down in a cafetiere.
That's it.
But if you leave that to go cold, the coffee grounds, which is what's left at the bottom, and then you smell it the next day, it smells like old fag ash, cigarette ash.
Fags.
It smells horrible. It just smells like cigarettes to me. So, and I think because it's burnt, a bit like cigarette is like a burning plant, isn't it? Well, obviously coffee is a bean, which is a plant. I think when something is burnt, because the coffee beans are roasted, aren't they, in a fire.
Yes.
That's where you get the flavor from. But I think a lot of the chemicals that are in coffee are also present in cigarettes. And I think there must be a similarity there. So I've always had my doubts as to whether coffee actually is good for you or not.
Yes.
But so, we won't start that controversy.
No, well, we're not starting. I don't think you're the first person ever to mention that, Steve.
I'm sure one day they would... I'm sure information about the health non-benefits of coffee would be suppressed, because imagine how powerful the coffee industry is. It was like the tobacco industry, you know, back in the 60s. They used to suppress all sorts of information and studies about how bad smoking was for you in order to preserve their product.
Yes, I believe the word is integrity.
Yes, well, they were trying to preserve the industry, weren't they? Of course, now they just sell cigarettes to poor countries they haven't got the information to be able to know that it's bad for you.
Okay, you know what? You're starting to sound like Alex Jones. He's one of these crackpots on the internet.
Thank you. A crackpot, am I, Mr. Duncan?
Well, that's what you're starting to sound like one.
Well, the thing is, supposedly there are lots of antioxidants in coffee, which is supposed to be good for you.
Okay.
As they say, there is in tea lots of... This is the buzzword, isn't it, around healthy eating, antioxidants.
Okay.
Which are supposed to... chemicals in food which soak up free radicals.
Okay. So where are we going here?
Damage your cells. Where I was going was that there could be chemicals in coffee that are bad for you, but they may be outweighed by the benefits of the antioxidants. do people still talk about antioxidants when it comes to food anymore? Is it still in favor?
Said it's a buzzword.
I think it is a buzzword. People always talk about, you know, if you eat blueberries, it's packed full of antioxidants.
Okay.
Which are supposed to be health benefits, aren't they? To give you great health benefits. And supposedly coffee has got lots of antioxidants in it. But of course, if you have more than three or four cups of coffee a day, it's supposed to be bad for you because of the caffeine. But then people say, well, why don't I drink decaffeinated coffee? But then that's bad for you because the chemicals used to extract the caffeine, there's residues left in there. So that's bad for you. So you don't know what to eat anymore. I'm rambling, Mr. Duncan. I'm rambling.
Are you okay?
I don't know. I've just started talking about coffee and that's it. You know what I'm like when it comes to health issues?
I really do regret mentioning my coffee breath. It's my fault. All I said was my breath smells of coffee, and that's it. We have a 12-minute TED lecture.
I'm off at a tangent.
We have a 12-minute tangent. Okay, yes, we have a 12-minute TED lesson or lecture from Mr. Steve. Great. Well, I enjoyed that.
How many cups of coffee do you have a day, Mr. Duncan?
One.
Yeah, same here.
That's it.
If I have more than, say, 2 cups of coffee a day, I start to get heart palpitations.
Okay.
Which is the obviously the caffeine. Do you know, there was a study.
Uh-huh.
Everyone knows that caffeine is in tea and coffee, and it's a stimulant drug. It's a drug, and it's a stimulant.
Yes.
But there was some ridiculous study, was it last year, where somebody said that it was all in the mind, that coffee doesn't make your brain work faster or make you more alert.
Okay.
It was all just in the mind. It's ridiculous. It's a drug. It's caffeine. It's a stimulant.
Yes.
If it makes my heart go funny,
yes.
And it's not because I'm looking at somebody that makes me excited. It's the coffee.
Oh, well, when was the last time you got excited by anything?
We won't go into that, Mr. Duncan.
We are talking about getting older today as well, by the way. But just before we get on to the other subject of St. Patrick's Day, signs that you are getting older. Let's have a look at the live chat. Now, here's something that I want to look at first of all. Signs that you are getting older, Steve. And here's a great illustration that I saw the other day, and I couldn't resist showing it. I really wanted to show this today. So there you can see a young person, a middle-aged person, and an elderly person. So the first person has lots of time, little money, but loads of energy. The middle-aged person has very little time, lots of money, and lots of energy. And I think the third one is you and I, Steve.
Thanks a lot.
Lots of time, lots of money, but virtually no energy.
Well, you haven't got lots of money, Mr. Duncan.
That's true.
No, I think, well, we're middle-aged, Mr. Duncan. We're not elderly. So that is true. We have very little time. I would put the money one maybe halfway along and the energy one halfway along because I don't feel as though I've got very much energy anymore. You know, middle age, I think your energy is already starting to go. I don't agree with what they've done on those charts.
Okay, here's another thing. Another sign that you're getting old, Steve. Here we go. You might recognise this.
Tablet containers with the days of the week on.
So when you get older, normally you start taking medicine. And so you go to the doctor because you've got something wrong with you. You say, please, doctor, give me some pills. But you have to take them every day or on a certain day. And so there you go. So that's a sign that you're getting old.
If you've got one of those. another sign, I think, Mr. Duncan,
yeah,
of getting older is that you start to go to more and more funerals.
Okay.
Because people that you knew, even people of your own age, start to die. We're middle aged. I mean, I when you're younger,
okay,
you don't go to many funerals, do you? Because you might go to your grandparents, maybe.
Yeah. Well, you don't have to go to them.
You know what I mean? More and more people that you know,
yeah,
or knew, start to die because you've lived a long time. So when you start getting into your 50s. I could go to a funeral every week.
I think I'm having an episode here myself.
Is that coffee grounds stuck in your throat, Mr. Duncan?
I think the coffee is having some weird effect. So signs that you are getting older. Oh my goodness, here's another one, Steve. Look at this.
Oh, you need big buttons
on your TV remote control.
because you haven't had your eyes tested and you can't see. Of course, you can get phones with big buttons on, can't you?
Yes.
I did suggest... my mother wanted a new phone.
Okay.
About 3 or 4 years ago. And we went out shopping for a phone. And I said, how about this one, Mum? It had got these giant buttons on it. I thought she was going to hit me.
She wasn't very impressed.
She wasn't very impressed. She said, I don't need a phone like that.
No.
You know, much to say, I can see the buttons. But you can get remote controls and phones with giant buttons on them.
Mm, this is true.
In fact, actually, I've got a smartphone. And you know you can change the settings for the size of the font and everything in a smartphone, can't you?
Yes. So when we say the font, we mean the size of the text.
That's right. So you can change the size of the text that appears, 50%, 70%, 100%, 120%.
Yeah.
The settings to change. Well, we've all got the same smartphones at work. I was with somebody at work who's probably... half my age.
Okay, then.
And we were looking at something on the phones, and they went, oh, good grief, what's that giant font on your phone?
Yeah.
Because, of course, I've set it all to be larger. They were quite taken aback by the fact that I'd had to, and I said to them, well, wait till you're my age.
Okay.
And you'll have to increase the size of the text that appears on your phone.
Well, this
they
is
were
it.
Quite shocked, taken aback. Yeah, in fact, really. They laughed at me.
Yes, probably. Well, probably for good reason. So here's another thing, Steve. If you have one of these... Oh, dear.
Oh, a chair with wings.
So a big high-backed chair with high armrests and little wings on the side. So when you have your afternoon sleep... Your head doesn't roll off the side of the chair. So if you have one of these in your house and you sit on it a lot, you like to sit on this in the afternoon, that might be a sign that you're getting older. What do you think, Steve?
Definitely, Mr. Duncan. Well, we saw on this shopping channel.
Okay.
That there is a chair that you can buy now that... assist you when you want to get up from the chair. And that is just, I mean, if you have to have a chair, I mean, obviously there could be medical reasons, but it just made us laugh because there's a chair where you can press a button and it tilts the whole chair forward so that you can get up easily from the chair. So I think if you've got to buy one of those, that's definitely a sign that you're getting either lazy or old. Of course, there could be very good medical reasons for that, but it made us laugh to see a chair that raises itself up at the back and literally tips you out of the chair.
Yes, it's pushing you out.
That's right. Because we've got a recliner, haven't we, in the living room?
Well, that's not the same thing, though.
I know, but it sort of makes you feel a bit old. When you sit on it and the chair reclines back, you feel like you're sort of, you do feel as though you didn't need that when you were in your 20s.
Well, they didn't really exist.
Let's have a look at the live chat, Mr. Duncan. People must be commenting about signs.
So recliners lift your legs up, so you have your legs up and everything is very relaxed. So let's have a look at the live chat because Steve wants to have a look at the live chat.
I do.
And then we're going to talk about St. Patrick's Day and then words and phrases to do with the weather.
That, of course, is another sign you're getting older, that your hearing starts to go.
Pardon?
Yes. Quite often, though, there is a difference between you sometimes say to me, you think my hearing is going, but in fact, it's just because I'm not listening.
Okay.
There's a difference between your hearing going and whether you're actually concentrating and listening.
Mm.
I find lots of different sounds make me a bit confused now or a bit stressed.
You mean like speech?
Yes. For example, driving with the radio on, I find it very distracting. And if there's lots of noise from different directions, I find that a bit I find that a little stressful. Yeah. That must be a sign that I'm getting
older. So what about the live chat, Steve?
I'm trying to write. Can't really see anything to do with signs of getting older. Becoming deaf, says Christina. Your eyesight going, definitely.
Yes.
Is a sign. Can you just go back a bit with the live chat, Mr. Duncan?
I will try my best. Let's go back a little bit.
Hearing, yes. How about a rocking chair?
Oh. You don't really see people with rocking chairs anymore.
I don't know whether you probably still can get them. I'm not quite sure.
Yes. I can't remember the last time I saw anyone sitting in a rocking chair.
There we go. Lydia says something interesting there. A lot of old people... sometimes if you see people in a nursing home, then the nurses seem to be speaking very loudly and slowly.
Yes.
To the people that are there.
A bit like we are.
Are you? Can you hear me?
Yeah, thanks.
Mr. Duncan?
Thanks for shouting there.
Are you okay?
You do realise when you shout, there are people listening out there with headphones on. Who are probably pooing their pants.
I don't think so, Mr. Duncan.
I think so. Talking of pooing your pants, did you see what I played earlier? So last week, Mr. Steve was pretending to be on the toilet, and I couldn't resist editing this little video clip. It is live English, and it's 25 past three on a Sunday afternoon. Can you believe it? To be honest with you, I certainly can't believe it. Thank you very much for joining us today.
St. Patrick's Day.
It is St. Patrick's Day, Steve.
Yes, do you want me to tell you something that I found out about St. Patrick's Day?
I'm going to be honest with you here. I don't know much about St. Patrick's Day. I'm going to be honest with you, Steve. I don't know much about it. One of the reasons is because I'm not Irish. So I suppose if you are Irish, then you will know a lot about St. Patrick's Day.
That's right. Well, I looked it up again to refresh my memory. St. Patrick is the patron saint of Ireland.
Hmm.
He was around in the 15th century,
okay.
So a long time ago.
The 1600s?
That's right, 15th century or 14th century. I think It was the 15th century. I think he died in the 15th century. A long time ago.
Okay, then.
He is credited with bringing Christianity to Ireland.
Ah, okay, now I understand.
That's right. So he is credited with bringing Christianity to Ireland. He wasn't actually Irish. He was actually born in Scotland. That's a bit of a surprise. But St. George, the patron saint of England, wasn't born in England. So there's a bit of a pattern there. So he was born in Scotland, but he ended up staying in Ireland because he had a sort of a calling, I think. And so he sort of converted people over to Christianity. So that was what he did. And he became a missionary, went all around the world. And he used to use the shamrock, which is a plant. I think you've mentioned that already.
Mm-hmm.
With it's got three leaves. It's a type of clover, I believe. But it's got quite big leaves. And that was used to symbolize the Holy Trinity, because it's got three separate leaves, so the Father, Son, Holy Ghost.
Okay.
So that was that's why he used that to demonstrate that. What else do I know about St. Patrick? Yeah, well, of course, we're in Lent at the moment, aren't we? If you're a Christian, you'll be probably following this period of time up till Easter. When you're supposed to do certain things like fasting, for example.
Okay.
But on St. Patrick's Day, of course, it's famous for being celebrated with lots of food and drink.
Mm.
So I'm sure the Irish will be having a great fun today.
Especially drink.
But it's celebrated in many countries around the world where there are lots of Irish people. So it's celebrated in America, Canada, parts of Europe, wherever there is. There, of course, there's a lot of expats, Irish people living in communities all around the world.
What's an expat?
Somebody who is from a particular country but doesn't live there anymore.
Yes, it means expatriate.
Yes, that's it. So so Irish people, for example, who are living in America might still think of themselves as being Irish, but they're living in America. If English people, if we were to go and live in another country, we would be called expats.
Yes.
So it's suggesting that you've sort of deserted your own country.
Yes.
It's to say you're an expatriate almost sort of says that you don't really have much loyalty for your country anymore, which I suppose in a way could be true, because if you've abandoned your country to go and live somewhere else because the weather's better or something, then maybe that's a criticism. I don't know.
Well, it just refers to a person who's moved away from one country to live in another.
That's right.
So I suppose technically, I suppose you could say their allegiance has changed.
That's right. Maybe they're very European and want to live in another country. Let's not talk about Europe or Brexit, Mr. Duncan. Let's not talk about that.
How many days before Brexit? Oh, 12.
12 days. Well, as we all know, that's not happening on the 31st of...
No.
I wonder what people think.
Not the 31st, the 29th.
About what's happening in this country at the moment, because we're all in a state of disbelief and shock.
Steve, I'm sick of hearing people say the 29th of March. I hate that date so much.
Well, they're now talking about an extension of up to 2 years. Well, yes. We can't have another 2 years of this, Mr.
Please.
Duncan.
I am literally having a nervous breakdown here. So nearly 3 years, 3 years we've been talking about Brexit and what will happen, what might happen. And now we're just 12 days away, and then they decide, let's not do it. Let's extend it. So we might have another 2 years of all this nonsense.
Oh. Well, I think I'm trying to follow it quite closely. They don't think that's going to happen.
Well, who knows?
Who knows?
There's another vote next week.
Well, there's another vote next week to try and get May's deal through that she's negotiated. If that happens, great. It'll all be over and we can just get on with our lives. If they still don't agree to that, and there's rumours now that they're paying certain people to try and vote in favour of of this deal, which...
Where do you get this information from, Steve?
Well, I listen to the news, Mr. Duncan, and I read.
So people are rumouring these things. These aren't facts. They're rumours.
Well, I saw the Chancellor of the Exchequer being interviewed this morning.
Okay.
And he was asked this question. Are you going to... Because the DUP is this Irish... political party that are helping to prop up the Conservative government, and they are now being rumoured to have been offered money in order to vote with the government on getting this deal through.
Okay.
If that is true, that is unbelievably... I mean, people will be appalled, I think, in this country if it comes to light that people are being bribed to vote in favour of a deal.
You do realise...
But then, of course, what's worse? People are now in this situation. Politicians are now faced with this. They've been saying that May's deal is awful and we shouldn't vote for it, which is why they've voted it down twice already. But now, of course, the clock's run out. Brexit's supposed to happen on the 31st of March.
The 29th of March.
So now people are faced with a situation of, shall we accept that deal, or what? Something far worse could happen. So you've got two bad worlds. Which one do you go for?
Yeah.
Because if we don't get any, if we don't vote for this deal now, although it's nothing to do with us, it's the politician. Well, then we're faced with this situation of having to ask for an extension from Europe to try and work out another deal. But if they say no to that, then we're going to leave on the 31st with no deal.
29th
with no deal. So, which is supposedly going to be a catastrophe for us.
You know, I really can't. Steve, I can't believe that you keep getting that date wrong. I literally, when I close my eyes at night. What?
The end of March.
When I close my eyes at night, the inside of my eyes now have the 29th of March sort of imprinted on the back, on the inside of my eyelids, because I'm sick of hearing people mention.
We're all sick of it. And just think of how much time all that politicians are supposed to be making laws and passing laws and getting things done. Nothing's happened for 2 years in this country because all anybody's concerned about is sorting out the Brexit mess. Yeah.
But it's worse than that. It's 3 years.
I know.
3 years we've been talking about
this. So we can't have another 2 years of it.
Please, no. Please, anything, whatever you want to do, you can have it. Whatever you want, you can have it. Just please stop talking about the 29th.
I think they're going to vote for it. I think they're going to vote for May's deal. That's my prediction. Oh. Because now that is, even though, I mean, I don't even know why it's supposed to be so bad. People say it's a bad deal.
Well, we
know about the backstop, but the rest of it just looks all right to me.
You do realise that no one knows what Brexit is. Even the experts don't know. No one knows. That's why I voted to remain. So I voted against Brexit.
We both did.
I voted against Brexit, not because I understood what it was about, but because I didn't understand.
Yes, because, you know, we've got a good life. We've had a good life in Europe. It's been fine. We know we're not poor. We're richer than we were in the 70s. But, so we said, well, it's not getting bad. No. So why come out of something that looks quite good? But anyway, that's very controversial.
Yes, but that's not what I said. I said I voted because I don't understand it.
Well, that's it. Nobody did.
I'm not on about the lifestyle we have now. I'm just saying I don't understand it. I'm voting for something that I don't understand. So I would rather remain and then we can find out what the hell it's all about and then maybe vote again later. Or we just stay. And so that's the reason why I voted remain, not because I knew what it was, but because I didn't really understand it completely. So you had these people voting to leave who really didn't understand it, because no one understands what it is.
What it really means.
And if you say that you do understand, you're lying.
I think people generally wanted, because when we first joined Europe in the 1970s, it was all about the common market. So we're all being able to trade freely around Europe without any tariffs.
Yes.
And that was a good thing. That created a lot of wealth and a lot of business opportunity. But then as the years have developed, people have become they're not happy with the fact that there's more political integration taking place and that decisions about policies and things that are happening in this country are being made by unelected people in Europe. That's been the problem.
Yes, but
it's moved away from just the common market.
Yes, but
to this sort of federal Europe.
But there are British
style, and a lot of people aren't happy with it. That's why.
But there are British people on the European Parliament. Mm. That nobody seems to actually understand that there are actually British people there making decisions as well.
I'm not saying I agree with them. I'm just saying that's why a lot of people have decided.
Yes. So basically, they might be idiots.
Well, let's not use that phrase. Because
quite a few disingenuous. Quite a few people have used that phrase.
Yes. We didn't fully understand what it was about. What it was about, which is. But of course, the problem the politicians have got is that most of the politicians didn't want to leave Europe. So there's a conflict there. So although the country voted only just that we wanted to leave, 52 was it to 48 to leave, more than that, but about 75% of politicians wanted to stay. So they've got to, and the problem is they've got to, we voted to leave, that's what's happening because you can't get, that was the democratic vote. You can argue that not enough people voted, or not enough young people voted, or that maybe if everyone was forced to vote, probably most people would want to stay.
Maybe,
that's not the point. Point is, we had a referendum.
Okay.
52% said we'll leave, so we'll leave. But then it's 52-48, so you can't have a hard Brexit because you're going to upset the 48%. So we're going to end up with a sort of a weird Brexit, I think, that tries to please everybody.
Yes, but it might be another 2 years that we have to wait.
I don't think it will be. I don't think that's going to happen.
Anyway, as Steve drinks his water. So shall we go to the live chat?
Just to
see if there's anyone still watching.
And I've got these. I've got a lot of these phrases to do with the weather, Mr. Duncan. We've only got 20 minutes left.
Well, that's 20 minutes.
I know. Well, you know how like to spend time on the idioms.
You certainly do. So let's have a look at the live chat, first of all. Is anyone still there?
Oh, hopefully.
Cursive English handwriting says, sorry for the interruption, but I am new here. Oh, welcome. Welcome to the live stream. This is a live stream that takes place every single...
I don't think that's up to date, Mr. Duncan. I think you need to go down on the live chat.
Yes, I know. I'm just looking at...
Oh, I see.
Yeah, just... What? Okay, then. Just calm down, Steve.
It's okay.
I'm just...
Soap opera. That is correct. It's a soap opera. Yes, a lot of people got their own opinions on Brexit, of course. Yes, well, we did, a lot of people did vote to leave because of immigration. It was immigration was the main thing, and it was also the fact that a lot of decisions are made now that we can't control in this country. But immigration, you see, that was a total lie that we were told about immigration.
Okay, anyway, Steve, I've really, really got to stop.
You want to move it on, do you, Mr. Duncan?
No, it's not. I don't really want to move it on. I just want to stop talking about politics.
Oh,
because you do realise that we've probably lost probably half of our viewers.
No, I don't think we have.
All right. Do you want to take a bet on that?
It's a very controversial subject.
Yes, but only controversial to people living in Britain.
I'm not sure about that.
Not anyone else living around the world. Yes, I've got my passport, everyone. I've got my passport. Let's zoom in on my passport. I have my new passport. It arrived yesterday. So now I can officially travel anywhere in the world. And in some cases, I can travel without a visa. Ooh, very nice. Now, the reason why I got a new passport was nothing to do with Brexit. Nothing to do with it. So I just want to clear that up.
Because it had run out, hadn't it? Your passport had expired.
My passport had expired, but I have my new passport with my lovely photograph. Oh, isn't that lovely? What a lovely photograph. Would you like to have a look? There it is.
Hideous. It's hideous. I've got Lewis makes a very good point, of course. One of our more senior viewers, that it's all about democracy and we must respect the democratic process, and that of course is something that Prime Minister May has said all along, that is absolutely vital that we leave, because if we don't, it's going to be a complete betrayal of the democratic process. Even if in reality, because only about 75%, I think it was only about 70% of people voted, but I think if you'd forced everybody to vote, that it would have been a different result. But that's the democratic process. That was the vote, 52-48. So we must leave, but it mustn't be a hard Brexit because it's basically just 50-50.
Okay, so
that's been the whole problem all along.
I just said
developing.
Okay, Steve.
A way to leave.
Okay,
that doesn't upset everybody.
At the risk of repeating myself, shall we talk about something else? Well, first of all, thank you for your lovely messages. We can't read all of them, of course, because there are so many. But Inigo says, why do people from the UK who live abroad call themselves expat, but people from Poland who live in the UK call emigrants? I don't think anyone says emigrants.
It's a different thing. Yes, that's it. So if we went to Poland, you would call us immigrants.
Yes.
You would call yourself an expat came here. I think there's a difference there.
But there is a very, very distinct difference in the fact that if you emigrate or if you are an immigrant, they sometimes are different things. So if you emigrate, you just go to another country to live. But an immigrant quite often will be someone who's going somewhere for economical reasons as well. So economic reasons, so that to get a job or get a better way of life. So there are many different types of immigrant. But I do take your point. And there is a sort of, I suppose there is a sense of arrogance that goes with a person who maybe lived in England or the UK or the United States, and then they go to live somewhere else. So yeah. Yes, I think that's a fair point. Yes, Inigo.
But if we went to work abroad, if English people go to live abroad, say we go to live in France, you're both. We're immigrants. Well, we would say we were immigrants. You would say you were an immigrant, but you would also call yourself an expat.
Yes,
That's just a phrase that we use when to ourselves when we're living in another country. We're still immigrants if we're living in another country.
Yes.
It's not that we're calling ourselves something to make it sound better. That is just that that phrase is presumably used to mean any group of people that you say that about yourself when you're living in another country. But if we went to live in France or Poland, if I went to live in Poland, I would be an immigrant.
Yes.
In Poland.
But you're more likely to call yourself an expat because it sounds as if you're still living your English life somewhere else. I think
But people do. I mean, we've got Polish communities here.
That's,
you know, if you go to live in a, like Irish people or Chinese people, they set up their own communities when they go to live in a country. They're immigrants. But they're also expats. That's just what we call ourselves when we go to live in another country. We're not trying to soften anything by doing that. Obviously, we are immigrants. Technically, you're an immigrant if you live in another country.
Okay, Steve.
15 minutes to get my words done, Mr. Duncan.
Yes. Well, you keep sort of talking about politics and things that send people to sleep.
Interesting. No, it's not. How do you know it's sending people to sleep? They might be interested. People are commenting.
Yes. Well, it's when the viewing figures go down. That's not near.
Brexit might. Yes, you see, that's the dangerous thing about Brexit. It's who knows what long-term effect this will have on Europe.
Yes. Anyway.
It's a very dangerous game that's being played here.
Anyway, at the risk of repeating myself yet again.
Okay. Can I get these done in 15 minutes? I've got 12 of them. So one a minute, Mr. Duncan, basically.
By the way, we will be back next Sunday, for those who are wondering, 2 p.m. UK time. Yes, I'm sure. Well, we might not do all of them. We will do the good ones. How does that sound?
I think Lewis has got it a bit mixed up there.
What?
That's just what expat just means, as you say, an expatriate, somebody who is living in another country.
Yes.
But you're also an immigrant at the same time.
Yes.
It's not about what you call yourself. It's about what other people call you.
Yes.
When you're in that country.
But
you wouldn't call yourself an immigrant. You would call yourself an expat.
But what they're saying is groups of people who live in one place, and if they're British, quite often they will refer to themselves as expats. If you go to Spain, they have communities that are just expat communities.
That's right.
They're not called immigrant communities.
Well, they might be by the local people.
Mm.
They'd be called that by the local people. Definitely.
Yes. I think there might be just a distinction there.
Well, what do Polish people call themselves if they're living in a community in the UK? It's what you refer to yourself as.
Mm.
So, you know, I think there's a bit of confusion there to what people understand by the phrase. So British people living in Spain call themselves expats, but the local people in Spain will call them immigrants, I would imagine. They won't call them expats. That's just a phrase we're using.
Or foreigner.
Or foreigner. That's just a phrase we use to describe ourselves. But Spanish people would call us immigrants, just as we would call Polish people living in the UK We would call them immigrants. It's not a derogatory term. It's just a phrase to mean people that have come to work here and live here.
Yes.
But maybe Polish people call themselves something else.
Yes.
That's the difference. Right, yeah. We've only got 10 minutes left, Mr. Duncan.
Well, that's because you were talking again about this.
I'm just trying to explain. There's no sort of racial undertones going on there. It's just terminology.
Yes. But you know how things can be twisted sometimes. Anyway, let's have a look.
Words to do with the weather.
Words to do with the weather. But we haven't really looked outside much today. So let's first of all have a look outside. That is a live view outside. And I always like to play a game called Can You See the Cars and the Vans? Now, I just saw a white van going across.
Ah.
And there's another one. That's going very fast, that one. I think that one, look at some of the traffic goes very fast. Look how fast.
I can't see that.
You can't see the cars going by.
No.
Please tell me you can see them.
Well, I can't see a road.
I really do think, Mr. Steve.
I've got a view of the country here, Mr. Duncan. I can't see any cars.
Really?
No.
You can't see the cars going by.
No. Well, I'm looking at it on a very small screen. Oh, there, I saw one then.
There we go, there's two.
That's it. Yes. But don't forget, you're looking at it on a big screen. I'm looking at it on a small screen.
No, I think between you and me, I think Mr. Steve needs glasses.
I think we're going to run over today, Mr. Duncan, just as Brexit's going to run over.
I think someone's going to run over you. So let's have a look at some words to do with the weather, because there it is, the weather today, looking outside. Isn't it lovely out there?
The weather is very windy.
It's very windy and cold. So, Steve.
First one, under the weather. Some of these will be quite familiar, but I've found quite a few sort of more obscure ones. Under the weather, what does that mean? It means you're feeling unwell, sad, tired. Under the weather, imagine lots of heavy clouds and rain pressing down on you. So, for example, sorry, I can't come to the party tonight. I just feel a bit under the weather. So you're not feeling very well. I heard you were ill yesterday. Are you better or are you still feeling under the weather? Oh, I've got no energy today at all. I went to that party last night and I got home very late and had too much to drink. I feel under the weather today. I think I've got the flu coming. I feel under the weather. That's used quite commonly. Now, you can have a fair weather friend. A fair weather friend is a friend who is unreliable, who only wants to know you or be around you when things are going well. They just want to be with you to go to parties and go shopping and have a chat and have a laugh and go out for a drink or a meal. But then when something bad happens to you or something difficult, suddenly they don't want to be any help to you. It's a fair weather friend. For example, I thought Julie was my friend, but she hasn't called me once since my divorce. She's just a fair weather friend. So they're not there to support you in the bad times. They're only there for the good times. Another example, John is just a fair weather friend. When my car was off the road for 2 weeks, he wouldn't even give me a lift into work. Fair weather friend. Well, Mr. Duncan, it has been raining very heavily outside. Yesterday we walked into town for our Saturday meal and we walked back in very heavy rain. It was raining cats and dogs. We got soaked to the skin. So raining cats and dogs just means it's raining very heavily. We will get soaked to the skin if we go out for a walk now. It's raining cats and dogs. Another phrase you can use, come rain or shine. If you use that phrase, come rain or shine, it's used to say that something will always happen despite the weather or difficult conditions or circumstances. For example, Julie goes jogging every day, come rain or shine. So she goes out for jogging, for exercise, no matter what the weather. But it doesn't have to refer to weather necessarily. That example was referring to weather.
But another example could be, I'll always be there for you, come rain or shine. So you're not meaning the weather there. You're meaning no matter what happens in your life, you'll always be there. Come the good times or the bad times, you will always be there. So whatever happens, you could use the phrase whatever happens to replace that. I'll always be there for you, come rain or shine. Save for a rainy day, or save up for a rainy day. We're talking about saving money here. So this is to put aside money or funds when times are good, in anticipation that things may be bad in the future. So building up savings in case something goes wrong, say your car crashes and you need to buy a new car, or you might lose your job in the future, and you want to have money saved up to protect you in bad times or rainy days, is that what the synonym for that would be. Every day looks good now, but what happens if I lose my job? We need to put some money aside for a rainy day. So a rainy day is when things aren't going so well and you might have lost your job, but you need to buy things. So if you've got savings, you're protected. Do you ever chase rainbows? So if you chase rainbows, it means that you're chasing something or trying to achieve something that is impossible or very difficult to achieve. For example, to be very topical, the politicians are chasing rainbows if they think Brexit will happen on the 29th of March. So if you chase, obviously, if you see a rainbow in the sky, you can never actually catch it. It's impossible to do. So chasing rainbows means to try and achieve something or go after something that's impossible or very difficult to find. Another example would be Janet is chasing rainbows if she thinks Paul will ever marry her. Another synonym, you could use the phrase a pipe dream to replace chasing rainbows as well, or have your head in the clouds, which I'll come on to now. The phrase to have your head in the clouds means to have unrealistic or impractical ideas about something, or it means just a daydream as well. So John has had his head in the clouds all day since meeting that new girl. I think he's in love with her. So he's in a daydreamy state. He's got his head in the clouds. He's not thinking about anything else but this new person he's just met. Another example, the boss has his head in the clouds if he thinks we're going to achieve those targets this year. So an unrealistic target, an unrealistic idea, to have your head in the clouds over something. Have you ever had your head in the clouds, Mr. Duncan?
I think my head is permanently in the clouds.
You often say that about me. Another idiom about clouds, to be on cloud nine. If you're on cloud nine, you're just blissfully happy. You're in a really ecstatic, happy state of mind. I'm on cloud nine. Joanne said yes when I asked her to marry me. Martha has been on cloud nine since she got her promotion at work. Now, nobody really knows where the phrase on cloud nine comes from. So cloud nine is a very happy place to be, but nobody really knows where the phrase comes from. There is one explanation that I think meteorologists used to name clouds, and the number nine cloud was this lovely, fluffy, wonderful cloud, but they don't really know if it comes from there. There's a lot of controversy about where cloud nine comes from, but it just means to be in a very happy and blissful state, like I am now
on the live chat with Mr. Duncan's show. I'm on cloud nine.
You're certainly on something.
But the opposite of that, Mr. Duncan, or the near opposite with that, is to have a face like thunder. A face like thunder. So obviously thunder, if you've got thunder clouds, they're dark, gloomy, miserable. So it just means to be obviously angry or upset about something. It's written on your face. You're really upset. You've got a moody, angry face. Oh, what's happened? You've got a face like thunder. Who's upset you? You might say to somebody. He didn't say anything, but his face was like thunder. He just walked out of the door and slammed it behind him. Have a face like thunder. You know, you can see that on people's faces. They just look really angry. Something's upset them. But of course, it could just be all a storm in a teacup. So if you've got a storm in a teacup, that means you're getting upset about something, and that is really just a very small problem, an exaggerated problem, not as bad as it seems. To get angry or worried or anxious about a minor issue or problem is a storm in a teacup. Because obviously, if you've got a small little vessel like a teacup, and there's a storm in there, it's localized to that small area. It's not a big problem at all. For example, don't keep worrying about what to wear to the party. You're getting upset over nothing. It's just a storm in a teacup. Bill is making a huge fuss about somebody parking in his spot at work. He's just making a big storm in a teacup. So somebody's parking in his spot at work, he's creating a big fuss. It's really of no consequence. It's just a storm in a teacup. We've had this one before when we've looked at idioms to do with snow. And this is to be snowed under, because obviously snow is a type of weather. It just means you've got too much to do. Can you give that project to somebody else, please? I'm just really snowed under at the moment. So you've got it's like you've just buried in some in work. I'll fix that leaking tap some other time. I'm just snowed under at the moment. Now, sometimes you might get in a fog, or you might get in a haze. Those two phrases can be used almost at the same time, or similarly, in a fog or in a haze. That means to be in a great confusion about something, or it means you're not thinking clearly, or you're not very alert. I can't think straight today. My brain is in a fog after last night's party. So just like being in a fog, you can't really see clearly. It's all a bit misty. There's no definite things that you can see. Everything's all a bit blurry. That your mind can be described as being in a fog. You just can't think clearly. I went around in a haze today for days after I lost my job. I've just been in a haze since my girlfriend broke up with me. So you can't think properly. You can't think clearly. You're in a fog or you're in a haze. Now I've got two more to do. Oh, we're running over, Mr. Duncan. I better do this one lightning fast. If something is lightning, obviously is a form of weather, thunder and lightning. It just means if you do something lightning fast, you do it very quickly indeed. And that can be an object, or it can be your behaviour as well. Wow, for example, your new Ford Mustang is lightning fast, said somebody to me at some point in the future. You got that job finished really quickly. You're lightning fast today. So there we go. It can be an object, or it can be something that you're doing. People usually refer to it as behavior, don't they, Mr. Duncan? Mr. Duncan got his live stream finished really quickly today. He was working lightning fast. And the last one is to get wind of something. To get wind of something. If you get wind of something, you begin to suspect something is happening. you get wind of something. So if you feel wind on your cheek, for example, that means something is coming, something is on the way. You can feel something. To get wind of something, it means that you suspect something is happening. It could be a rumor. I think there will be big changes at work since this new boss has arrived. Now, if you hear anything, if you get wind of anything, will you let me know? Peter got wind that Jane was cheating on him and confronted her. So if you get wind of something, it means you've got, you're hearing something, some rumours maybe about something that could be happening. I'm getting wind that today's live stream may be coming shortly to an end. Am I correct, Mr. Duncan?
You might have a point there, Steve. Now, this is my new fad, by the way. This is my new health fad this week. I'm eating oranges, and it's Mr. Steve. Mr. Steve introduced me. It does work better if your microphone is on. This is my new health fad, and can you see what I'm eating? I'm eating oranges. Ooh, oranges. Now, Mr. Steve introduced me to these. He said you should start getting some more vitamin C. So I'm eating oranges. So that's exactly what I'm doing at the moment. I'm having a nice orange.
Part of your new regime, Mr. Duncan, your healthy regime. We won't talk about the weight loss, which isn't really happening. But you are starting to eat a bit healthier. I have never known you in 30 years to eat any type of fruit. This may come as a shock to some of Mr. Duncan's viewers, but he never eats fruit, or very rarely. Actually, sometimes it does upset his throat. But you've been eating oranges for the last week, and I think your skin has improved dramatically. I don't know what the viewers think.
Thanks,
but
Steve.
I think your skin is clearer and fresher and newer and younger.
Wow.
You've been eating two oranges a day, have you not, yes. Mr. Duncan?
I've got another one here.
I'm very impressed.
So these are very small oranges. They are very easy to peel. You can get the skin off very easily.
Can we have a last look at the live chat?
We are going in a minute. The live chat is still very busy. There you go, Steve.
Oh, Sicily have very big oranges. Well, that was very quick. How long have you been eating oranges, Mr. Duncan? How long have people been able to see you eating oranges?
For some time.
Throughout my... Well, you mean you were upstaging me?
No.
You were trying to upstage me, Mr. Duncan. I don't like that at all.
I don't know what you mean.
Yes. A suspicious mind, somebody said, for the phrase to get wind of something. No, it doesn't mean a suspicious mind. It just means that, and you've heard a few rumours. Yes, suspicions. Yes, maybe you're suspicious about something that's happening. Yes, you are right. Something big may be happening. I eat oranges every day, says Christina, and grapes. I have. You've got to eat five. What they say to be healthy... now, don't they? The recommendations are that you eat five portions of fruit and veg a day. Although they've recently upped that to 10.
Okay.
Potatoes don't count.
Yes, a few people have said that that looks like a tangerine.
Yes, it is.
That's exactly what it is. It's a small orange. It's a type of orange. It's a tangerine.
Do you remember a few weeks ago, Mr. Duncan, we were talking about idioms and phrases to do with babies?
Yes.
And you laughed out loud when I used the phrase crack baby.
Okay.
Which means a baby that is born to a mother who is taking crack cocaine.
Okay.
And you laughed and said there's no such phrase as that.
Well, no.
And we were watching a television program last night, were we not, Mr. Duncan?
Yeah, but I didn't say... Wait there. Before you start slandering me...
I'm not slandering you.
I didn't say I didn't think it was real.
You laughed.
I laughed because it sounded funny.
It sounded funny. Well, we watched a TV cop series... did we not last night, and they used that very phrase, crack baby. So I felt very smug. Anyway, why? We laughed. Yes, laughed.
Yes, but I didn't think it wasn't real.
I know. All right, Mr. Duncan, don't get upset.
I just...
I'm not being serious.
It does sound funny.
It does sound serious, but it is a phrase used, I think, in America to describe a baby born to a mother who is hooked on crack cocaine.
Yes, because apparently what happens, the baby also becomes dependent on cocaine.
Mm, exactly. That's, I think, is what I said.
That's incredible, though, isn't it? So the baby is born a drug addict.
Spanish oranges, yes. Seville oranges. We always used to get oranges. I remember when I was growing up, oranges from Seville were famous. And my mother always bought Seville oranges to make marmalade because apparently they're very good for making marmalade. I think Seville oranges were, I think they were not quite as sweet as other oranges, but they were very good for making marmalade, and my mother always bought Seville oranges. So I don't know if you can still buy them. Maybe you can,
but there are different types of orange. You have the large orange, a small orange, tangerines. There is also mandarins.
Yes, Lewis makes a good point there.
Clementines.
Yes, I can't tell the difference between tangerines, clementines and mandarins. No, I can't. Tangerine, I think there is supposed to be a slightly different flavor, but you can't really tell. I think tangerines are a very, very bright orange.
There was a great progressive rock group called Tangerine Dream.
Yes.
Many years ago.
Oh, Sydney, they've got a tangerine trees in their small farm. How lovely.
Oh.
Jeff says that, yes, crack baby is used in the USA.
Yes. It just sounds funny.
It does sound funny, actually.
It doesn't sound like a phrase that is real. Crack baby.
How about a pot baby? if the parents are smoking weed, can you have a pot baby? It's probably not very serious, is it? Whereas a baby that's born hooked on cocaine is probably quite serious.
But I'm just now imagining a baby with a marijuana spliff hanging out of its mouth. I don't think it works. It doesn't work like that, does it?
A baby comes crawling out of the womb and then searches, looks for a bong to smoke on as soon as it comes out.
Searches for a what?
Well, isn't it a bong? Isn't that something that you use to smoke drugs?
I don't know.
Well, the baby comes out of the womb and then immediately looks for a needle to inject themselves with. Yeah, you could use that in a cartoon. It's not funny.
No, but...
We're making light of it, but it's obviously not funny.
How about you are making light of it? Anyway, we're going now, Steve.
We are going because we are going... I am going to make some hot cross buns and a cup of tea.
Oh, that sounds great. I am absolutely starving. I haven't eaten anything today. I've eaten nothing.
Nothing?
No, that's what I just said.
Just a few small slices of orange.
Yes.
Segments of orange.
Yes.
You describe those... What you were eating there, a segment of orange.
Okay. I don't know why I'm laughing. We're going now, Steve. We have to go now, unfortunately.
How sad. I've just livened up.
Yes. I don't know what it is. You always start to liven up. You used to fall asleep in the past. You used to start falling asleep, but now you seem very lively.
Nobody's commented on my shirt, by the way. Jeff always used to say, comment on my... On my dress.
I
haven't had that for weeks.
I thought that was Pedro.
Was it?
Pedro used to compliment your shirts.
Well, I haven't been complimented for a long time.
Anyway, let's go, shall we? Because I think everyone's tuning away.
Bye-bye.
Steve's going now. See you next week, Steve.
See you next week for more controversy and more talk about Brexit.
And hopefully something interesting.
Bye.
And there goes Mr. Steve. He'll be back next week. He's now going off to make a cup of tea and a tea cake. I get the feeling that Steve might also be a little bit hungry as well, because, you know, doing this, it makes you very hungry. 2 hours I stand here talking to you. In fact, 2 hours and 12 minutes today. One last look at the live chat. And then we are out of here. Matrix says, Mr. Steve's shirt is very nice. Thank you, Lilia. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Guadalupe. My mother prepared homemade orange marmalade last week, but she didn't take out the little white veins, so it tasted quite bitter. I like marmalade, but I don't like marmalade with the skin. So normally they have the little shreds of skin inside. So I don't like that. So I like marmalade without the skin, to be honest. Matrix says goodbye. Thank you, David. Thank you, Sydney. Thank you, Martha, as well. Thanks a lot for joining us today. And I hope you've enjoyed it. It's been interesting. Some moments of controversy. One or two things that we wanted to say today. And, well, of course, I will see you next Sunday from 2 p.m. UK time. Have a great St. Patrick's Day, by the way, if you are celebrating. And, of course, during the week, you will see lots of new lessons, a new English lesson every day. I'm not joking. Every day, a new lesson tomorrow and Tuesday and for the rest of the week, every week. And I will be back next Sunday from 2 p.m. UK time. You can send a donation to PayPal. The address is going by underneath right now. And of course, well, you know what's coming next. Of course you know what's coming next. Until we meet again here on the 30-year-old World Wide Web. Ta-ta for now.